to my kid. It didn't matter if the kid did well or not, because you could tell sometimes they didn't. There was just a look on the facilitator's face like, oh boy. But you know, but no, on the mother's face. On the mother's face, there was that love and that joy and acceptance at the child and the value in the child himself, not in his deeds. So every mother, I encourage you to always just let that shine, as I'm sure you do. The second thing, though, that children really need that's an attribute of God is that there's a corrective and adjustment attitude in God with his relationship with us. He wants the very best for us. So sometimes he has to bring correction. Now, correction is not a favorite word in society today. So we kind of changed that. My husband said, let's start calling it adjustment. So now when people say, am I going to get corrected? We say, we're going to help you with adjustments. Not really. Isn't that a superior word? Look at somebody right now and say, do you love adjustments? You see, in Proverbs, in the book of Proverbs, it says, in the book of Proverbs, it says that the wise person loves adjustments, but the foolish person hates them. So sometimes we need adjustments. Our children need adjustments. In society today, there seems to be a concept of parenting that's either hard parenting or soft parenting. You know, from one extreme to the other. For instance, in hard parenting, it's correct, correct, correct. It's drill instructor. It's a general parenting concept in the sense that you do what I say, you think what I say, or what the way I think, etc. And they never develop and blossom and begin to have a choice in their thinking. And so there's another concept, though, that is soft, you know, parenting. And in soft parenting, we let the children do what they want. They often even call parents by their first name. The parent is more of a friend than a guiding light to that child. Now, see, God is not really like that, because God knows the values that will best cause each and every person to fulfill their destiny and their created plan that he has for them. And so we as parents must make sure that we're not just being friends. We have to make sure we're not just afraid that if we lay down some rules and some regulations that, you know, sometimes our children say, I hate you. I'll hate you forever. They'll get over it. Take my word for it. They will. You know, we cannot just allow them to go their way. Why? Because children only have hindsight. They don't have foresight. But we have foresight because we've already been through some things, haven't we? And how we wish that we had listened to our parents in some way. Can I get an agreement on that? And so we have to make sure that the answer with children is communicate, communicate, communicate. Value with the words of your mouth. Value with the looks on our faces. But at the same time, we have to communicate why we believe that the Word of God is important. Why do we believe that prayer is important? Why do we believe that coming to church is important? Why do we believe that not being conformed to the image of the world is important? Why do we believe that embracing God's ways and His will is the best possible thing in our lives? And so it's communicate, 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 because just telling people things is like kind of like the Old Testament law. You know, the law stands back and says, do it this way, and then watches you to see if you do. And it doesn't encourage you, doesn't really motivate you, but it's always there to condemn you when you miss it. But God's word, as we communicate the why, and it takes time. You know, did you ever help a child make a bed? Did you ever have for a goal for a child to make his own bed? Is that a challenge? And you know, we want to go in there and just do it for them. Just, here, I'll do it for you because it's easier on me. And we do that with the value of, just do what I say, with the values of life. No, we have to explain so that they have the thinking process. Amen. So that they embrace that process. So not only is it communicated to them, but it's communicated, they can communicate it to their friends. This is why I don't do drugs. Amen. This is why I don't engage in premarital. This is why I still pray. Amen. This is why the Word of God is my guiding light. And so that they can be a light to their parents. Amen. and or to their friends. But parents have to be the ones that talk. I know we go to the gym and we work out sometimes, actually. I haven't been in a long time. But we do that sometimes, and we get what? Muscles. These are the best muscles you'll ever have for raising your children. Right here. And this tongue is a muscle. And to talk, so that they understand the whys of the choices we make, so that they can make those same choices. Because there'll be a day and a time when we will not be there to make the choice for them. Will they have the godly wisdom to make the choice themselves? And I know I'm looking at parents today and you're saying, but it's too late for me. I've already done the best I could do, whether I knew how to do it or not. So what's left for me? Hannah's prayer. When I think about Hannah birthing, she went to that, Hannah was a woman who was barren in the Old Testament, and she went and she cried out at the altar of God, and she said, give me a child, give me a son. She was so specific, not just a child. She said, give me a son. And when, and she so emptied herself, so she was so into it in the spirit that the priest thought that she was actually drunk. She says, I'm not. I'm just praying out such a depth of my heart. I've got to have a son. So today, see, when she had that son, she committed him to God and she took him into the temple and he was raised there. But he was raised by Samuel or by Eli, who was ungodly. And he had ungodly sons. Now you would think, with those bad role models, what chance would there be of Samuel, who was became her son, ever becoming a godly man? And yet he was. He was such a powerful prophet and judge that God let none of his words ever fall to the ground. Everything he ever prophesied came to pass. And you think, how did he ever become that in that role model, those whoremongers, you know, sons of Eli, and Eli himself a compromiser? How did he ever become? Because she never quit the depth of prayer. She never quit interceding with everything, pouring her guts out before God, saying, you've got to keep him. Do you hear me? You've got to keep him. You've got to enable him to reach his destiny. I know I did the best I could and it wasn't always good enough, but God, you are the ultimate parent. So I am crying out, I'm pouring out my heart to you. Your will for my son, my daughter's life, nothing more and nothing less. I won't take anything less. And I don't want anything more. So today, be a Hannah. Receive the Hannah spirit today, I pray upon you, to pour your hearts out before God at the altar with everything within you, no matter where your child is today. Some may be in prison, some may be on the streets, some may be in ungodly places or relationships, but your prayers will make a powerful difference. So pray with all of your heart. Never be ashamed of praying with all of your heart. As I spent time with Pastor Sherry, she's one of those women that cries out with all of her heart to God for the maturity in her own family and also in you, the body of Christ that God has entrusted she and Pastor Steve with. And I want to honor her today. I just want to say, Pastor Sherry, we love you. You know, John and I and our whole family just thinks you are wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And we honor you today and thank you for being the epitome of a mothering spirit. Can we get our hands together? God bless you.
And you too.
God bless you.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, we want to bless you, Pastor Sherry, your church family. We've got a couple things for you. You're going to be blown away by each of them, but especially the second one. Why don't you come on up? These are some love gifts from your church family that you and Yazzie and even Pastor Steve can take a spa day. There's some gift cards in there, money's in there. You can go and be totally blessed from head to toe. Amen. So I know you're going to love this.
We love you.
Yes, we do. Going to take this next one, so you have your eyes come back here. You got to look at the screen, okay?
Hallelujah!
Yes, They're getting ready. Girls, you ready? Okay, Pastor Sherry, as I was minding my own business, the Holy Spirit spoke to me during Mother's Day. He said it was to be light, to be happy, and to be something right off your bucket list.
I feel the need for speed.
Up to 165 miles per hour, adrenaline pumping, blood jumping, spirit rejoicing, 18 laps at Disney's Richard Petty Driving Experience. Completely legal, you're in the driver's seat. This amazing event will be videotaped. You behind the wheel and the track in front of you, pictures included in your dream ride. Sorry, no ambulance chasers here. Your gift card is, that's your gift card. So don't lose that, okay? And this is your plaque. You will get two pictures. You get to pick out which ones. The plaque's already bought for you. And this is some words from a couple of, well, two youth and one child. To me, Pastor Sherry means a lot. She's such a strong, caring, and kind person. I love her with all my heart, Jillian. Pastor Sherry, you mean happiness to me. You are very sweet. You teach us to trust in our heart. Love, Madison. Pastor Sherry, you mean so much to me. I love you so much. You're cool to hang out with, and I'm your other only daughter. You have too much swag, Michaela.
Wow. And that's spelled backwards, it's still wow. Wow, that's all. Thank you. I don't know what to say at this point, but I am ready to make that appointment. Praise God. Wow, that's awesome. You know, thank you. He loves us with the blessings of God, doesn't he? And that is a bucket list thing. And when you delight yourself in the Lord and you do what God tells you to do, you are blessed exceedingly beyond you could ask or think. And I'm sure there's a bunch of people to thank, and I don't know who, so thank everybody that was involved. Praise God. I don't know what to do now, so this is the first time I've been speechless. So, Pastor Steve, I'm giving this to you. I don't know. What am I supposed to do now? Offering! I can do that. God is good, isn't he? He is so good. I am just hoping it's a red race car. Praise God. Praise the Lord. I am like happy, happy, happy. Oh my goodness. That is an incredible gift. Thank you, Lord. You know, that's the way it is with Jesus. He's exceedingly abundantly beyond. Isn't he beyond what we could ever ask or think? He is so wonderful. And I just want to receive the morning tithe and offering. We have, as usual, never the same service in two Sunday services. Amen. And so ushers, come on ahead. We want to bless and honor the Lord today. Amen. He is the reason why we are breathing. You know, I love that teaching that Dr. Rebecca just taught. We are Hannah's in the heart, aren't we? We cry out for the need that we have for God. He is our everything. And I just had two scriptures in my heart as you're writing. And we have another offering today at the end of the service for Dr. John and Rebecca. Aren't we glad they're here today? I'm just so excited about them being here. Amen. And I want to go over to, first of all, I want to go over to 2 Timothy, if you have your Bible. And let's look over here at 2 Timothy chapter 2. And I just had gotten this on my heart. No soldier, no good soldier, that's verse 4, 2 Timothy 2:4, in active service entangles himself in the affairs of everyday life. Yeah. Amen? We're bought with a price. And you know, I wanted to focus on this because it says we don't entangle ourselves. We've got to make a choice not to be entangled with the world's system. Amen? And so that he may please the one who enlisted him as a soldier. And I know that this, I probably never coupled this verse with over, let's go over to Acts chapter 3. But my point is this. When God calls us into the army of God, we're in the family of God, we're in the army of God. You know, when people go in the service, they aren't concerned about what they're going to wear. I know Dr. John was in the service. He was a Marine. And, you know, he didn't go in and wear his own clothes. They provided the clothes. They provided the room. They provided the food. They provided all the things that caused him to be triumphant in the military. And I know he carries some records for some major, like the most push-ups, the most muscles. I don't know. He's got a bunch of records that he still has carried because he took his job seriously as a soldier. And when we're in the body of Christ, God is our provider. And we don't have to be entangled in the affairs of this world. We're not in the world system. We're in the word system. Yeah. Amen? And over here in Acts chapter 3, I love this verse because it says over here that, you know, we see that Peter and John are at the gate, and it's the temple, beautiful, and they're going to pray for someone who's, you know, has a some kind of impairment. But what I wanted to focus on is not the healing, but it says this, verse 15, actually, it says in verse 16, and on the basis of faith in his name, in the name of Jesus, this man has been strengthened. And you see, know, and the faith which comes through him has given him perfect health in the presence of you all. And I like what the King James says. It's through, it says, in through the name and faith in the name, this man has walked. And we need to believe in the name of Jesus. That's been the theme this morning in worship and praise. And it's in the name of Jesus that we have our needs met. It's in the name of Jesus. But it's not just in the name. It's in the name and through faith in that name. A lot of people know about the name of Jesus. Even demons know about the name of Jesus. It says they know about the name of Jesus and they are in fear and trembling. But what are we doing about the name of Jesus? We've got to have faith in the name of Jesus that he is going to meet all of our needs. He's going to provide for our needs to be met, our bills to be paid, for us to have ample provision in every good source. And his word has no expiration date. What he says It means it, it will do it, it will perform it, but there is a Godward side and a manward side. And I just want to encourage you today that we have faith in the name of Jesus. Do you have faith in the name of Jesus? So we know that God's going to meet our needs. He's going to provide for our cares, our desires, even our wants. Amen? And so I just want you, you know, I don't know what your week has been like, but I'm sure there's challenges. I'm sure the devil tries to wake you up with cares and worries. But you know what? We cast all that on the Lord. He's the one who meets our needs. He's the one who pays our bills. He's the one that when we trust in Him, we'll never be disappointed. You know, anything I've ever believed God for, He's never disappointed me. Amen? And so I just want to encourage you and just cause your faith to just buoy up and just say, you know what? It doesn't matter what it looks like. I may have to pay this, and I may have to be paying double payments on this or doing something with this, or my house is still in debt and I'm flipped. You know what? God says, I can flip you right back around. And I can cause your debts to be debt-free and cause you to walk in victory. So we got to believe the word of the Lord, and we got to believe the faith in Jesus' name. Amen? And so I just want you to say it. I believe. And let's just lay hands on our offering today. Let's put it to some good use. You know, the Lord told Brother Hagin when he was sick one time, he hadn't been sick in 39 years. He said, I hadn't had a headache in 39 years, and he got sick. And the Lord said to him, you know what to do. Lay hands on your own self. He laid hands on his own self and got his healing, and he was struggling with it. And sometimes we just need to do what the Word says, and we lay hands on our own situation. We stand on our own. Nobody can pray better than you when you know how to pray. And we know how to pray, amen, because we're anointed to know. And so we just thank you, Father, first of all, that you meet our needs. You are our everything. You supply all of our needs according to your riches and glory. And so, Father, we thank you as we give our offering, our tithe. We bless you with the mighty name of Jesus, and we stand under that covering. And now we speak to any debt, any bills, any lack, any kind of deficiency in our finances. We curse them from roots right now. We say we're free from debt. We're free, and we have wisdom to get out of debt. We thank you that every bill is paid, every need is met, and things that need to be sold are sold. Things that need to be brought in will be brought in, and promotions are coming from the north, south, east, and west, because promotion comes from the Lord. And we just thank you. We agree the good word of God is coming to work in our life and on our behalf right now. You said as we give, it will be given unto us in a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and overflowing. So we stand and believe in Jesus' name. Say it so.
It's so.
In my life.
In my life.
Amen. Yeah. Praise God. Woo! I love the Lord. Let's give the Lord a shout. Amen.
Must I say I never Praise God. I got chills going down my spine from that. Amen. Praise God. Isn't she anointed? We're blessed to have Sister Cheryl here. She, the other praisers, just, we got good people. Amen. And I'm proud of you. I am so happy today, and we're privileged to have our overseeing apostles, Dr. John and Rebecca Polis, with us today. Amen. And we are excited what they share with us. They were down receiving a word, and they may say something about it, I don't know, but they were receiving a week's teaching on some coaching. I mean, they never stop. They just keep on expanding and learning more. I mean, they already know so much from the Lord, but they always stay humble and hungry, and it just blesses me so much. It's an inspiration to me to see that they just want to keep on going and learning and winning more souls and reaching out to the nations. And you know, that ain't easy stuff, my friends. It's not easy to do that, but they don't care. They're the Green Beret. Amen. I want to let you know, remember when I said, when I first time I saw Dr. John, he had gotten off a plane and we were going to meet in a place to eat, meet with the whole group of men and apostles. And when I saw him over in, I think it was South Africa, it was over in the other area that we used to go to where Sam was. Johannesburg. But I saw him walking, and the Lord, I didn't know him. I didn't know him from Adam. And all of a sudden, the Lord spoke to me, and he said, look over there. And I looked, and the Lord said, there's my spiritual Green Beret. He said, he's my special forces teacher. And right from that moment on, I knew God had supernaturally connected me with that man's ministry, and I have been so blessed and loved on to be part of both of their lives. And so I always appreciate when you are in the area coming over and building us up and sharing revelation and the good word of God with us. Amen. Amen. So anyway, let's give them a hand. Let's stand up and praise the Lord. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much. I appreciate your reception, your warm reception of me. Thank you. And many of you I know have been here before, and it's great to see all of you again. Always great to be with Steve and Sherry, whom we admire so much for their love for God and their consistency of their faith to never quit, never give up either, even when it's hard.
Amen.
We know it gets hard sometimes, don't we? I want to talk to you for a few minutes today about what to do on your worst day.
Amen.
You've ever had what you thought, this has to be the worst day of all right here. Well, we have heard some wonderful exhortation this morning, and I celebrate you for the way you've honored Pastor Sherry. God's a God of honor.
Yes. Amen.
And Jesus spoke a lot about honor. And when you become an honoring person, there's really no greater quality you can have in your life than to be a person that's honorable, the top of the chart. And so you all have done that with great excellence today, and I know God's going to bless you all for how you have honored the spiritual mother of the house. And I appreciate my wife. She did a good job exhorting us, didn't she? Not to mention how pretty she is today. Golly. Woo! We're talking 40 years here, people. And she still makes me go, woo!
So,
we have four children, four grown children. Our oldest is 38, and our youngest is 32. And we have six grandchildren. And we have a blessed family. And we thank God for all he's done. And without a great mother, that wouldn't have happened. She's been the great mother and made up a lot of slack where I wasn't always the greatest father in my early days. So she had to be that much more of a great mother And so she filled in a lot of the gaps for me. And it all worked out good.
Amen.
And if you have your Bible, let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 30 this morning. Wonderful to have God's presence with us, isn't it? Such a beautiful way today. Thank you, Lord. In verse 1, we have this story. The text, actually, it's about 20 verses, and I won't read it all, but we'll be hitting some of them. This is a story about King David, and I think probably the worst day of his life. And how he handled that bad day, we can learn some things from him. The background of the story here is that King David had been out with his band of 600 marauding men, and they were going throughout the land of Judah, and were in the land of the Philistines, and they were really cleaning up some things that were left behind when God gave the land to the children of Israel. He said, I want you to exterminate all of these pagan people that worship false gods here in this land. If you don't drive them out, then they're going to grow up and become thorns in your sides. They're going to become a problem. Listen, whatever you leave in your life from your BC days is going to become a problem to you.
Amen.
So, you know, the Bible says put off the old man and put on the new. Okay. So, David is out with his marauding guys, and he's kind of cleaning up the rest of what was left behind. And while he was away on one of his trips with his men, something terrible happened in the town of Ziklag, which was a city that was given to him by the Philistines to live in, and to take all his people there. It says in verse 1, now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag, attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were there, from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but carried them away and went their way. So David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire. And their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. This is probably as bad as it could get, huh? Can you imagine that? It says in verse 4, then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail, the widow of Nabal the Carmelite, had been taken captive. So here's David, I believe, on the worst day of his life. Just think about your background, what you've been through. You suffered great loss in your life. It might have been a loved one, it might have been a child, it might have been a job, it may have been a home, it may have been health.
Yeah.
You suffer great loss and you find yourself in this position. Hallelujah. Listen, I have a word for you right now. God has a way to recover all that you have lost, and that's what you're going to see. And I decree it over you and speak it over you today that your losses are going to be recovered. And not only are your losses going to be recovered, but you're going to take the spoil of the enemy who plundered you and took from you, and you're going to get it back sevenfold. Can somebody say hallelujah? God. That's what's in this story here. It's a story of recovering all of your losses. But you got to know what to do on the worst day of your life. And that's what we learned from King David. And so in verse 6, it's bad enough the way it is, but it gets a little worse. In verse 6 it said, then David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and daughters. So now David has lost his loved ones, his family, his children, all his possessions there. Ziklag were taken captive. But not only that, all of his leaders and the people that he had fought with and lived with, and they were a tight band of people, they're turning against him now and blaming him for the losses that they're experiencing in their life too. Have you ever had that happen when the closest people to you? I mean, you're already hurting. You've already suffered a great loss. You've been hit really hard. And then the people close to you start finding fault with you.
Yeah.
Like Job, right? Start finding fault with you.
Yeah.
You must have did something wrong and putting the blame on you. Well, in verse 6 here, here's something that we have to learn first and foremost. David's losses were the result of an enemy. Your losses are the result of an enemy in your life.
Yes.
John chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, the Bible said, the thief cometh not but for to steal, kill, and destroy. I want to assure you today that all that you have ever lost was the work of an enemy in your life.
Yeah.
And that's the first thing David understood, that it was the Amalekites who'd come in and plundered him. So what was stolen from your life, the losses you've suffered, has been the work of an enemy. And I want you to know this today, brothers and sisters, that many times when we suffer loss and tragedy happens, we immediately think that God is punishing us for our sins. Must be God punishing me, because only God knows how bad I've been and all the bad things I've done. But I want you to know the good news in Romans chapter 8. God's not punishing you for your sins. Hallelujah. Can you say amen?
Amen?
God is not punishing you for your sins for this reason, because he already punished Jesus for all of your sins. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 30, it's verse 31, it says, what then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword, is written? No. Nothing can separate us, come on, from the love of Christ. Hallelujah. Whatever losses you've suffered in your life have been the work of an enemy. And God is not punishing you for your sins when tragedy happens, because God has already punished Jesus for all your sin. God is the judge of all the earth. He's the supreme authority. And if he has said you're not condemned, then who can condemn you? If God has said you're justified and not guilty, then who can lay any blame to you? Right? So God, you're not being punished because of your sins when bad thing happens to you. You need to know that. When plunder happens and bad things happen and tragedy happens, you need to understand that this is the work of an enemy in your life. Okay, so what did David do? First of all, let me say this. If we've been justified by God and there's nobody that can condemn us, in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 12 says that we've been delivered from the authority of darkness, translated into the kingdom of his dear son. Then how is it that the enemy can get a hold of us and plunder our life? You shouldn't be able to do it. Come on, can I get an amen? No, you shouldn't be able to do it. Hallelujah. The Bible said, Jesus said, the prince of this world comes, but he has no place in me. In the Amplified, in other translations, said there's no opportunity for Satan in my life. Okay? So there must be some way that the enemy can weasel his way into our life. We've been delivered from his authority, from God's his authority, and translated into the kingdom of God. I'm going to give you three things you've got to watch out for. Okay?
Amen.
Number one, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 21. The Bible says that we need to be renewed in the spirit of our mind. We need to put off the old man and put on the new. Come on, can you say amen? Say it with me. Put off the old man and put on the new. Let's just look at this scripture real quick, if you have your Bible there. Ephesians chapter 4. Because this tells us how, even after we've been justified and declared not guilty by God and delivered from the authority of Satan, that he ended up getting in and able to plunder our lives.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I hear the Lord speaking. He's just saying, I don't want the devil to do that anymore to your life.
Amen.
I don't want you to suffer any loss. I don't want you to have anything stolen from your life. That's what God's saying to you. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
How many hear God speaking to you today? Woo, shout out about high time. God doesn't want anything taken from your life further. And I believe today we're going to close the door on the devil.
Yeah.
Tell your neighbor, no more plundering of your life. Go ahead, no more plundering. Ephesians chapter 4 in verse 21, it says, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust. You remember what I said? Israel left those tribes in the land, whatever they left behind, whether they didn't get rid of, when God told them to get rid of it, it grew up to become a thorn in their side and became a problem in their future. Okay? So it says here, and be renewed, verse 23, in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which is Jesus, right?
Yes.
The new creation man on the inside of you, which is made in the image of God. That you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. See, that's your true nature.
Yeah.
Your true nature is righteous and holy. Amen. That's who you really are.
Amen.
But you find my grace. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. All things have passed away and all things. Shout with me, all. All things have become new. As Christ is, even so am I in this world now. I'm a Jesus man. I'm a Christ person. Hallelujah. If you've seen me, you've seen him. Come on. That's what Jesus said. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. That's me and you. When you get your mind renewed, you want to say, you want to see Jesus? Look right here. What did Peter say? Look on us. You see, we got one issue. I want to take a little side journey right here. We got one issue with all the eschatology that we have in the body of Christ today and all the division over the eschatology. The angels told, eschatology is teaching about the end times. The angels in Acts chapter 1 verse 11, they told the disciples, why stand ye here gazing? Quit looking in the clouds for Jesus. Woo, come on. Why stand you here gazing, looking in the clouds for Jesus? Man, I feel a rap anointing coming on the radio. Why stand you here looking in the clouds for Jesus? Come on, watch out now. I'm going to try to get through this and not get all carried away and keep you here. But the angel said, why stand you here gazing? Don't be looking for Jesus in the clouds all the time. Because we are the body of Christ now. We are the corporate son of God in the earth. The church is. We need to be doing what Peter said. If you want to see Jesus, quit looking in the clouds and look right here.
Yeah.
Well, because we've got the people distracted from the real message. We should be telling the world, instead of looking for Jesus in the clouds every day and every earthquake and every this, that, and the other means Jesus is coming. We should be telling the world, you want to see him? Look right here.
Come on.
Come on, show him some Jesus now. Show him some Jesus now. I said, show him some Jesus now. Come on. Come on, tell your neighbor, show him some Jesus now. I have news for you. He ain't coming back until the world sees him in you and me. Well, now I won't go no more into that one. He will come back. The angel said that this same Jesus whom you see go up shall so come again in like manner. But we're not to be standing here telling everybody to be looking in the clouds for Jesus all the time. We're to be telling them, look here to see some Jesus. Right? And we'll give you some Jesus right now, such as I have. Hallelujah. Give my hand to me. All right, verse 25 now, back to the message. Therefore, putting away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Wow. Let's stop right there. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. Verse 27. Neither give place to the devil.
Amen.
Don't give the devil any opportunity. In other words, by not putting on the new man and continuing after being born again to live like you did before you were Christ, before you were saved, what you're saying to the devil is, come on, man. I'm really identified more with you than I am with Jesus. And you know, the devil goes where people identify. Oh, come on now, watch out here. The devil goes where people identify more with him. And when you live in the old life, even after you've been born again, the devil still thinks you're one of his.
Yeah.
So he thinks he can take anything you got.
Well, that's right.
Tell your neighbor, the devil's a liar. Right. Okay, so number one, you want to close the door on the devil in your life. Put on the new man. Like the Bible said. All right? Be renewed in the spirit of mind. Realize who you are. You're not an old sinner. You're a new creature. Start acting like it.
Yeah.
It's not even your nature to sin.
Amen.
Did you know that?
Yeah.
I remember the day God told me that, you know? Because I said, you know, Lord, I've lost my interest in doing the things I used to do. And he said, well, because it's not your nature anymore.
Amen.
It's not natural for you to sin.
Amen.
It's unnatural for you to sin.
That's
as a new creature in Christ. Yeah. That's why it don't feel right when you do it.
Yeah.
You know, something that's natural feels right when you do it, isn't it? That's why it feels right when you do what Jesus would do, because that's your nature now.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. All right, the second thing that allows Satan the door into our life to steal, kill, and destroy is not putting on that new man. The second thing is not being vigilant. 1 Peter 5:8 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, for you have an adversary. The devil goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour." The word sober, vigilant, it just means to be serious about your Christian life.
Yeah.
Be serious about the reality that there is spiritual warfare, that you have an adversary. You have to be serious about the fact that you have an enemy.
Yeah.
That's what he said, be sober, be vigilant, be serious, because you have an adversary. You have to understand that this is a warfare. And you have an adversary who's going to look for any opportunity to get in and steal, kill, and destroy that he can in your life.
Right.
And so many of us, as Christians, we can allow ourselves to become spiritually dull. Not really be serious about our faith. Well, I don't know about if I'm going to read the word today or not. I don't feel like reading, or I don't feel like praying, or I don't even feel like going to church. You know, there's a story about this pastor that got up on Sunday morning and he said, I don't want to go to church today. I'm going to go play golf today. I'm not going to church. So he doesn't go to church. He goes to the golf course and he gets ready to tee off a big 400 yards and he tees off. And this wind, see, God and Gabriel are watching. And this wind comes and blows that ball right into the hole, and it's a hole in one. And God turns around to Gabriel, or Gabriel rather, turns around to God and says, God, why'd you let that happen, Father? And Father said, well, who's he going to tell? You heard that before. Who's he going to tell? You skip church and do it. You can't go back and tell him, you know. Be sober. Be serious about your Christian life. Because the enemy is serious. God is serious.
Yes.
You and I need to be serious, okay?
Yes.
The third way that we allow the enemy a little place in our life is in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 11, where Paul said we should not be ignorant of the wiles or the strategies of the devil, and that is to not be educated. So this is a little negative. Not putting on the new man will get you in trouble. Not being serious about your Christian life will get you in trouble with the enemy. He'll get in somewhere. And not being educated about the enemy. That's why we have teaching in church. That's why we have all the wonderful teaching that you get in this church. And you and I should have a student mentality. I showed the Lord just say something here today. Woo! Glory. He said, I'm going to give you the mentality of a student. I'm going to make you a student. I'm going to give you a mind and a hunger to want to learn today. I'm speaking a word of impartation over your life right now. God is saying that I'm going to give you a hunger and a mentality to learn, a hunger and a desire to learn my word and to become a student, because some in here have never really become students of the word of God. They've been casual readers of the word of God. And God said, that's not enough. That's not deep enough. But today I'm going to give you a mind to be a student and to study my word. And you're going to find out you can't get enough. That's going to be your new attitude. I just can't get enough. Woo, glory, because you're going to go into a season of education in the word of God. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's not just a prophecy, that's a grace and anointing in your life. Paul said, when I'm with you in Acts 1, in Romans 1:8, he said, I want to see you to the Romans that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift.
Yes.
That's part of the apostolic ministry, isn't it?
Amen.
To release anointing into your life, to release grace in your life. The grace anointing will touch you and change your life. Brother right here in this orange shirt, I just see you, that's you. God's getting ready to show you some things. He's going to show you how to build your life. He's going to show you where there's some mistakes that have been made and you've made in your life. Who hasn't? This has not been said to embarrass you. But God's going to begin to point out to you some things that maybe you haven't prior acknowledged or been willing to acknowledge, some things that need to be adjusted. Because you are a son of God and your Father loves you. And every son whom he loves and receives, he adjusts.
Yes.
And the result of that, he's going to bring you out bigger and better and and I just hear building, man, building. I don't know if you're a builder or you're going to build something or you're built, but you're going to be building. Okay, so just. Okay, you're going to be building, all right? So, hallelujah. Let it be in the Bible college that it's something's going to get built. God's going to continue to tune you up and adjust you in some areas and make you, I hear, squeaky clean. It's going to be good, man. Yeah. Every branch in me that bears fruit, he prunes it that it may bring forth more fruit, the Bible said. And if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you can ask what you will and it shall be done. Herein is my Father glorified that you bear much fruit. God is going to bring you into that much fruit stage in life. Somebody say praise the Lord with me today. All right. So, David, what have we learned so far? On his worst day, he understood this wasn't God doing this to me. This was an enemy doing this to me. And David was guilty of one of these things here. He wasn't vigilant. That's a new word, man. It's the digital age. Hey, wow, if you use digital things, that means you're vigilant. Hey, I just made a new word. I like that, don't you? All right. Well, David took all 600 guys with him and left the women and children by himself. He wasn't being vigilant, was he? He should have left somebody back there to protect his stuff. Well, he learned that. Okay, so we have learned that it was an enemy. We've learned that God's not punishing us for our sins because he already punished Jesus when something bad happens. And what we need to do is take a little responsibility, examine our own lives and see if I'm putting on a new man. Not talking about living in guilt and condemnation. I'm talking about just being a responsible Christian.
Yes.
See, there's a lot of confusion today about the importance of obedience. You know, it's all about faith. You know, faith in the grace of God. But where is obedience? What is important about obedience in our life as a Christian? You know? Because we all understand by the grace of God that I've been made righteous because of Christ's obedience.
Yeah.
Right?
Amen.
My obedience doesn't make me righteous. Christ's obedience makes me righteous. Let me share this nugget with you. This is a great thought right here. I love it. In the Old Testament, blessing was based upon the obedience of the people, right?
Yes.
They had to obey. If they obeyed, they were blessed.
Yes.
If they disobeyed, they were cursed. But in the New Testament, our blessing is not based upon our obedience, it's based upon Christ's obedience.
Yes.
And guess what? Christ fully obeyed and made us righteous through his obedience, and therefore there is no more curse.
Yes.
There's only blessing in the New Testament. Hallelujah.
Glory.
Woo, come on, let that sink in. Let that sink in. There's no curse in the New Testament. There's only blessing. Because Christ was fully obedient and gave us that righteousness, and there's no more curse. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. We are blessed. So shout out with me, everybody. I am blessed.
Woo!
Yeah, not because of my own righteousness, but because of his. Yeah, and his obedience. So what is the importance of obedience? Obedience is important because obedience makes you grow up spiritually.
That's right.
See, obedience, you don't obey God to get God to bless you. You obey God to grow to maturity where you can walk in the blessings you already have in Christ.
Yes.
Because he's blessed us with all spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Hallelujah. We're already blessed.
Yes.
We have it all. All things are ours. You know what the scripture said? But if I don't grow up spiritually and mature, I can't walk in all that belongs to me. And that's the importance of obedience.
Amen.
So obedience makes me grow up.
Yeah.
Makes me mature.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. All right. Now, we got to put on that new man. Woo! I feel like singing now. We got to put on that new man. We got to be sober and vigilant, right?
Yeah.
And we got to get educated.
Yes.
And we close all the doors to the devil.
Yes. Yes.
And he has no place in us.
Hallelujah.
All right, so what did David do? Here's what the devil wanted to do, and this is what he wants to do in your life. He stole his family, he stole his kids, he stole his goods, but he couldn't steal his faith. All David had left after the devil took everything out of his life was his faith.
That's good.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And listen, if the devil gets in and takes everything you've got, if he doesn't get your faith, guess what? You can get it all back with your faith. Hallelujah. And what Satan is really after is getting you to give up your faith. He really wants to take your faith. But if he can't take your faith, praise God, then you can take back everything the devil stole from you. And not only take back everything he stole from you, but you can take all the spoils. Hallelujah. Woo! You can plunder the enemy. Absolutely. Okay. So David, see, here he is, man, back in 1 Samuel chapter 30. The devil took all his stuff, and everybody's mad at him, but he didn't get David's faith. Look at verse 6. In the last part it says, but David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. He strengthened himself. What did he turn to in the midst of all of that tragedy on his worst day? He turned straight to Jesus. He turned to God. He turned to the Lord because he understood God's not doing this to me. An enemy has done this. And I may have allowed some of this to happen through my own lack of personal responsibility, but God is on my side. Hallelujah. And so he turned to the Lord. Woo, I love it. Three things, and I'm going to finish. Three things David did. Number one, the Bible says he encouraged himself in the Lord. Number two, the Bible said he entreated the Lord. And number three, he experienced the blessing of the Lord. We're going to take a look at that real quick. Number one, he encouraged himself in the Lord. Praise God. How did he do that? The same way you and I have to do it. Put on the music.
Put on
the worship music. Put on the music. Put on the praise tape. You've had a tragedy, something bad is happening. It's the worst day of your life. It can't get any worse. What you need to do is get yourself in the presence of God. That's how you encourage yourself in the Lord. Come on. In his presence is fullness of joy and pleasure forevermore. Woo! So get the music out. Put on that worship music and just get in the presence of God. Numero uno, number one. Encourage yourself in the Lord. The second thing is, you know, meditating the Word of God. Getting back in the Word. I have a lot of scriptures here, but I'm not going to take the time to do that because to read them all. Psalm 33, Psalm 34. I encourage you to read Psalm 33 and 34, all of them. Because it talks about David and how he encouraged himself in the Lord. I do this frequently. When I'm at the end of my rope, man, I just go in my office, I close the door, I turn off my cell phone, I put on that worship music, and I just lay there before God like a dead man. Because I've come to find out I can't do nothing anyway, so I'm going to quit trying. I'm just going to do nothing. They that wait upon the Lord, hallelujah. They shall renew their strength. He encouraged himself in the Lord. And I do that. And I'll just lay there. Woo! And be there. And I know, Lord. He said, I'm there with you. I know. And I'll lay there and he'll just be there with me. And I sense his presence and I'm in his glory and we're face to face. And I don't do nothing. Be still and know. See, after you come to that place of stillness, you can know something. God will begin to reveal things to you. Revelation knowledge comes at the end of you. Amen. When you be still, you start knowing some things. You know what you need to do to plunder the enemy. You know what you need to do to get the victory back. Hallelujah. You get the plan and the strategy for your life. Come on. I say you get the plan and the strategy for your life. Woo! Glory, hallelujah. Many of you you need answers right now. I want to tell you, brother and sister, it's not hard. Just go and get before God and get quiet and wait. Don't go in and pray. Don't warfare. Don't intercede. Don't do nothing. Just be still and you'll know something. There's a time for warfare, intercession. There's a time for petitioning. But there's a time to be still and know. This is the third dimension of Christianity, which is another whole subject. So he encouraged himself in the Lord. He got his faith built up, in other words.
Yes.
He built his faith up. See, he still had his faith. That was all he had. So he said, I got to build my faith up. I got to fan this flame, this faith into flame here.
Amen.
Stir up the gift that's in me because I'm getting ready to go back to war here. Hallelujah. The devil hit me. I'm getting ready to come after him. Come on.
Yeah.
I'm going to make him sorry he ever messed with me. Come on, shout hallelujah. It's an attitude you got to have. So he encouraged himself in the Lord, and then it says in verse 7 that David said to Abiathar, the priest of Amalekites, Ahimelech, here we go, Ahimelech's son, please bring the ephod here to me. And Abiathar brought the ephod to David. The ephod was what the priest used to question God and receive direction from the Lord. And
right.
That's a whole teaching which I'm sure you guys have taught. We, thank God, have the Holy Ghost and we're led by the Spirit of God. He's our ephod, amen? And so he encouraged himself in the Lord, built up his faith to where he said, now God, I'm ready to do what do I need to do? He inquired of the Lord. And then it says in verse 8, so David inquired of the Lord, shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered, thank God, when you inquire of the Lord, what's he going to do?
Answer.
He's going to answer you. This poor man cried, David said, and the Lord heard my prayer, and he delivered me from all of my afflictions. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from them. All of them. Hallelujah. And so, it says here, he inquired of the Lord, and the Lord answered and said, yeah, go ahead, pursue them, for you shall surely overtake them and without fail recover all. Can I tell you, that's God's plan for your life. Listen, I got to tell you something, the best is yet to come. I prophesy to you, the best is yet to come in your life. Now, it may have looked so bad. The tragedy may have been so horrific. You don't think it could get any worse, but I'm telling you, God is going to restore, recover all, and pay you back. Somebody say, hallelujah. And so, David, then the Bible said he had inquired and he got the direction from God, and he experienced the blessing of God, because it says in verse 9, so David went and he took 600 men, and there's the whole story there. But I want you to go on down with me, if you will, to verse 16. See, in order to experience the breakthrough, the victory, the restoration, recovery, you have to act. You have to do something.
Yes.
I remember just one quick little story. When I left Bible college, Rebecca and I, in 1980, went to Dayton, Ohio to pastor our first church, a little Pentecostal church with 25 people. And it was a nightmare, but I won't go into that. I had done a job for a guy who was a drapery installer in Bible college the last 2 years. I hung custom draperies in beautiful places for Ethan Allen furniture. And I'd done a job, and the guy wrote me a check for $400 and some. And I went to Fairmont with that $400 and some and opened a bank account. That was the money we had. We went to Fairmont, West Virginia to pastor that church. We opened our bank account. And we told the church people, we said, now, we've been in Bible school 4 years. We haven't had a vacation. I've been working full-time all the while. And we're going to go to Tulsa after they elected us as their pastor for 1 year. We said, we'd like to go to Tulsa to Kenneth Hagin camp meeting for 1 week and get filled up and blessed and refreshed, because we've been at it for 4 years here. And so they said, okay, go. If you can afford it, we're not going to give you any money to do it. But if you got the room, go ahead. So. We were all excited. We were going to take off Sunday, that first Sunday after church, and drive out there to camp meeting. And lo and behold, we get a notice in the mail on Saturday that our checks had been bouncing, that we wrote on that $400 check that we were given for our job. And this brother wrote me a bad check. And so here we are. We can't go. Come on, we've been plundered, boy, right here. And so we can't go to Tulsa. We didn't get to go to camp meeting. We didn't have any money. We had to stay right there and go to work. And so after I got over my anger, I encouraged myself in the Lord, and I inquired, you know. And God said, write the guy a letter and show that money to him. Just tell him, you don't owe me this money anymore, that $400 and some. I just give it to you. God said, just sow that into his life. And so I did. See, that was my strategy for recovery.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And take it back. The next year, a guy shows up at my house, and he says, he's a friend of mine. He's a wealthy guy from over in Ohio. He come to my house, and he looked down, and he said, would you like to go to Kenneth Copeland's victory thing down in Atlanta, Georgia? next week? I said, well, sure, who wouldn't want to go? But I'm not prepared to do that. I hadn't planned, I'm not prepared. He said, that's not what I'm asking you. Do you want to go? I said, well, sure. So he hands me $1,000. He says, here's your money to go. And you've got a room at the Omni Hotel there in Atlanta, right next to where the convention is. And so God paid me back not only that $400, but a week of Kenneth Copeland's meeting paid for. I ate at Pity Pat's porch every night right there in Atlanta. And went to the COPA convention for a week, all paid for, came home with money in my pocket. Can somebody say hallelujah? Oh yeah, God's plan is that you recover and all. Amen. So it says in verse 17, then David attacked them from twilight unto the evening of the next day. Not a man of them escaped except for 400 young men who rode away on camels and fled. So David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away, and David rescued his two wives, and nothing of theirs was lacking, either small or great, sons or daughters, spoil of anything which they had taken from them. David recovered all. Then David took all the flocks and herds they had driven before those other livestock and said, this is David's spoil. So David got all the stuff that they took from him and everything else that they took from everybody else. He got all that too. He recovered all and took the spoil. This is God's plan for your life and what you do on the worst day of your life. You got to remember an enemy had done this. You got to remember God is not punishing you for your sins. You got to take a little responsibility and make sure you're not giving place to the devil. Even if you did, just repent and then go to God and say, okay, Lord, he didn't take my faith. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Build up your faith. Get your plan from God and do it and recover all, not only everything that you lost, but more. There's more coming. The best is yet to come. I got to prophesy that to your life. You have abundance in your future. Woo! Your lack is in the back. Come on. Your future is full of finances, full of blessing, full of abundance, full of prosperity, full of money, full of miracles, full of all the best that there is. It's all yours. Hallelujah. The best is yet to come. Come on, somebody. Stand on your feet and praise God with me. Let's stand up and give God a praise. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Lift your hands and praise the Lord. Amen. Shout glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory. Praise you, Lord. Bless your holy name. Oh, we receive it, Lord. We receive every word of it. We believe it. We take it. Hallelujah. And devil, your back, we're going to again break it. Even though Jesus did it, we're coming in behind him. Amen. Praise God to do it again. Say, I'm going to do it again. Receive a double portion. Double for my trouble. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. How many, I know, I'm thinking, you know, hearing the word that Dr. John's giving, I'm thinking certain people in this church, I'm like, oh, that's exactly what they need. Oh, that, I mean, I need it, but I'm like, yeah, oh, I'm, you know, my mind is going, being the pastor, I'm jumping from, and you know, the Lord specially designed that word for you today. Yes. How many of you say that word, like, spoke right to me? Amen? It's like, it encouraged me. Amen? Well, praise God. I think we all need that. You know, that's, you don't need somebody to come up and prophesy over you all the time, and because that was all prophetic. Yeah. That was like the one big prophecy. Amen. What we need to do is do what the man of God said and receive that word, especially about diligence in the Bible, be vigilant. And now we're going to approach it with a lion's heart and chew it up, amen, like steak, and eat it up and regurgitate it, eat it again like a cow, amen, until it turns into the sureness of the word. Praise God. Well, we're going to receive an offering. We get to receive an offering for Dr. John and Dr. Rebecca. So if you could lift your hands, please, and do your best for them. Listen to the Holy Ghost and be led One of the things I learned a long time ago is if I obeyed the Holy Spirit and I was led, then I was obedient to God, and God increased me. And the main reason I would always do it is because I wanted to bless the person that had blessed me with the words, with the time they spent with God. You know, these words, they're years and years of refining. They don't come out in a day. They come out in years and years of ministry. And that's where I love to honor the men and women of God that have paid the price to feed me and help me change my life. Amen. And that's one of the reasons why I'm careful to obey God in those areas and make sure that I'm taking care of them, because they're bringing me the food I need. Amen. And that's more important than money. That's more important than silver or gold or anything. And we should feed those that feed us, the Bible said. It says, it talks about how if those fed you spiritually, that you, how much more should you feed them with natural things? And that means financial and so forth. But you know, I was thinking about this, and you know how it says there in Romans 10:6, it says the righteousness of God speaketh on this wise, the word. When I was thinking, what does righteousness speak? It speaks the word. It doesn't speak the negatives. The word is the good news, the Bible says. It's the glad tidings. Thank God we've got an encouragement in the Holy Spirit. He's our comforter. He's our guide. And sometimes, bless God, we aren't going to make it without the word. We need the word. And it is the glad tidings of the gospel. And we need that gladness. We need that. It carries us through and encourages us. And so it says that the word, the righteousness of God speaks the word. And that's you and me. We speak the word. And it says, what does it speak? It says, the word is in your mouth and heart. The Lord said, it's in two halves, in your mouth and your heart. That's a word of faith. Amen. Not the word of fear or unbelief or sadness, but the word of faith, which we preach. And then down there a little later, it says, how beautiful are the feet of those who carry the gospel of peace.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All that call upon the Lord shall be saved. So he is a Savior. If we're calling upon him, he's the Savior.
Amen.
And I thank God for that. And as we're here right now, if you would just bow your heads. I never like to have a service where we don't make an altar call. I don't want to see anybody leave here feeling any guilt or condemnation. It would be hard to after this message. But if you do, and you're being attacked in your mind and your emotions and all that, and or you feel like you need to rededicate your life to the Lord, I want to pray for you. So if you would lift your hand, we're all going to pray together a prayer. I see that hand. And you know, you say, I haven't been exactly living the way I could have been living, and I want God back in my life. Lift your hand, or you need to be saved. Amen. I see that. And bless you, brother. Or I need to be saved. Okay, let's all pray this prayer together. Father, in Jesus' name, I come to you. I believe that you raised Jesus from the dead. And you said in your word, if I confess my sins and believed in my heart that Jesus was raised from the dead to make me righteous, I receive that righteous nature. Thank you for clearing my path, washing me in the blood. Give me a fresh start. What's done yesterday is under the blood. I will not bring it up again. You don't even remember. So I thank you now, Lord, for forgiving and healing me and restoring me. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Praise God. I wanted to say Happy Mother's Day myself to all the moms. We have flowers up here that we did not pass out yet. I guess we must have missed that part. Got kind of caught up. So we're going to have, we have Rosie come up and also Pastor Missy. Can you come up and pass the roses out to the moms? And we just want to honor you because it's a good thing to be a mom. And you guys are special and we love you. So you are the flower of your children's lives. Remember that. You're the fragrance to them. Amen.
Look forward to seeing you. I'll be ministering or Pastor Gene.